God doesn't give you the exact same sermon that he's going to give Thompson over there in North Park. because they have different needs in separate congregations.
Right.
I wish I had a witness here. In fact, if they need to understand something that now sometimes I call my brothers and we look like everybody preach on the same thing. There are sometimes the Holy Spirit moves in such a way, there's such a accord of the Spirit that He wants to get the same message out across the land. But there's also times when He deals with addressing particular needs. Wish I had a witness here. I don't go to a general practitioner for him to give me the medicine he's giving everybody. I wish I had a witness. I got a doctor. The doctor won't know what's wrong with you. That's why I came to you. I want you to tell me what's wrong with me. I can tell you what hurt me. I can tell you what don't seem right. But I need you to accurately diagnose my. That's why they have to give tests. I wish I had a witness. They give you certain tests to try to discover what your fallacy is, what's wrong with you, and once I find what's wrong, then I can address. You know, the biggest problem in medicine is not solving what's wrong with you. The biggest problem is finding out what's wrong with you. Go find yourself in trouble. John, do it. And you know, this stuff is not just true with churches, it's also true with individuals. Now, a lot of y'all are going to look at somebody else and decide who's closer to God. Based on how much I had. Based on your comparisons. I love the Lord more because I dress right when I go to church. I love the Lord more because I sit close to the front. And the demons sit in the front. I wish I had somebody. That you want to make comparison as to who you think is close to God based on your comparing yourself with folks you want to compare yourself with. You know, I always told you, and you always try to pick somebody you know messed it up. Because they got to mess up real bad in order to make you look good. I wish.
Whoa.
But I got to be careful making comparisons in order to judge how close I am to the Lord. That's what they did. They came to Jesus and they said, well, what's the problem? What's the problem? Not the Pharisees' basic flaw, but they compared Jesus' disciples because they felt like Jesus' disciples were too cheerful. See, I'm going to be talking about that last year. I'm going to talk about it again. Because it's all through Scripture. And that's what Jesus is saying. You have a problem with my disciples because they appear to be too happy. You judge spiritual strength on the basis of practicing self-denial. See, a lot of folks, they judge how strong people are spiritual by what they don't do.
Huh.
I'm stronger than you because I don't drink beer. You drink beer.
Well,
I told y'all we drink root beer. I'm stronger than you because you go to clubs, I don't go to clubs. I'm stronger than you because you fat and I'm fine. Look at your spirit eye. A lot of times people are judging folks based on what they deny themselves. And so it's in the context of this fasting thing. Jesus, now look at what Jesus said. Jesus didn't say fasting is wrong. Don't get it twisted. Jesus didn't say fasting was wrong. But what Jesus did say was that you don't fast when things are right. Time you really fast is when something is wrong. Now, first of all, you need to understand something. He said, my disciples don't fast because, now he makes a comparison of a wedding. Yeah. You know how you always pick up weddings? Hmm. He said, you don't fast while the bridegroom is still with you. Yeah. I'm talking about understanding. I have weddings for an hour or two. But see, in the old days, they had weddings, they had to celebrate that for about a week or two. And they were literally partying during that time. And so when the bridegroom was there, it was more about a feast than about a funeral. Yeah. Jesus says, when you have the presence of the Master, you don't throw funerals, you throw feasts. I said, the Bible doesn't say anything against fasting, but now look at it. Remember that time when Jesus told the disciples they should have been fasting? Remember that he was on the mount, came down, and he cast those. I mean, y'all remember that. And when he said, why couldn't we do that? And Jesus said, this kind comes only by fasting and prayer. I wish I had a witness. In other words, he said, you fast when you need some help. You fast when you're falling short. You fast when the Holy Spirit doesn't have complete control over you. Well, now look at it. He said that when you have a bridegroom with you, you don't need to fast. Well, now, saints only didn't have the bridegroom with them for a short period. But the Bible said that when Jesus was on the cross, he was taken away from them. When they put him in the ground on Friday, he was taken away. Saturday, he was taken away. Uh-huh. Yeah. Early Sunday morning, he rose. Huh? Some of you don't get it. He said, I'm going away, but I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to send send you a comforter, and when a comforter came, you can't stay you alone. Yeah. What are you saying? I'm saying Jesus' absence was temporary. We were without comfort temporarily, but when the Holy Spirit came, we got somebody with us all the time.
Yeah.
Y'all don't pray for me today. I'm just trying to tell you, you don't have an excuse to be sad because it's Monday, because the Holy Spirit stays with you Monday, Tuesday, Friday. Come on, here, somebody. But I'm going to say, a lot of folks think, I tell y'all, y'all make a mistake, y'all confuse the manifestation of the Spirit with the presence of the Spirit. That's why y'all tell me, Lord, send a new anointing, send your anointing. Well, he doesn't have to anoint you, you've already been anointed with the Spirit. See, when God, I told you about, when God saved you with the Holy Spirit, he gave you all the Spirit you're going to get. Y'all better hear me. See, so you're in error when you say, send me some old Spirit. Baby, you can't handle the Spirit you got. Come on, hear somebody. See, your problem is not that you need more Spirit. Your problem is you need to let the Spirit you have more control. Come on, hear somebody. See, somebody's right. And I can understand something. See, the Spirit doesn't rise and fall. He doesn't get full and empty. It's not about that. But his influence on me can rise and fall. See, God will never force himself on you. You got to allow him to have the choice. You make a choice. You have some control over how much control you allow God to have in your life. And where you mess up is when you allow the devil to take control of some stuff God is supposed to be in control of. You have no reason to be sad, but you ought to be glad. You ought to be comparing your companion. That if Jesus is on your side, you ought to have a good attitude. Yeah. What reason do I have to be sad when the Lord is with me?
Sad.
What reason do I have to give up if God is standing right with me?
Lord.
What reason do I have to give up all hope and God is my hope and my help? Somebody ought to know what I'm talking about. One of the sweetest members I ever pastored, she died with the view of the Lord. Her daughter was, again, one of the sweetest members I ever pastored. And the girl sit there during the whole funeral of her mom and didn't shed a tear. She sit through that whole service, didn't shed one tear. Looked at me, heard me preach, heard the whole service, her face didn't change. When the service was over, you know, and our folks can say some stupid stuff. The rumors were, she must not have loved her mom. Because she didn't even cry at the funeral. I don't y'all ever say that's about as stupid as all get up. You cannot judge how much somebody loves by how much they cry at the funeral.
Say it, say it, say it.
In fact, it's just the opposite. I told you before. Usually, the people who act a fool at the funeral is the one that do a wonder-wine thing when they were alive. Do I have a witness here?
You got it.
See, the reason I had to sit in that funeral and I had to shed a tear, because when my mama was alive, she was right there by her side.
Yeah, yeah.
When my mama got sick, she was right there by her side. When my mama was in the hospital, she was right there by her bedside. And when you do all you can do,
yeah,
and
yeah.
I wish I had somebody, and the Lord called me to run from home, you don't have to cry. And they didn't want to accept the new.
Yeah.
They were dealing with Judaism and Jesus was dealing with the kingdom. Come on here, somebody. And kingdom principles just don't compare with Jewish practices. When you remember when Paul, you read through Acts, when Paul was converted and he started moving around, one of the biggest problems Paul had, they had what they called Judaizers. Judaizers, I should say. They would follow him from town to town. Because every time he made a conversion, they would go to those churches and say, well, it's not enough to accept Jesus Christ, but you got to also accept our practices. Come on here, somebody. You got to also follow the rules and regulations of the Jews. And so they tried to put all of those restrictions on us. And Paul eventually had to go to the church and get them to understand and say, hey, you can't accept, ask these people to have to take all that stuff, because none of that stuff don't save anybody. Well, y'all remember me like I'm talking about somebody else. Let me bring it on to 2020. That a whole lot of times we want to declare folk not close to God because they don't follow regulations.
Yeah.
Well, I have a witness here. I was teasing the choir because they was putting the word out, men ain't gonna wear gray suits today. And that's why I wore my gray suit today. I have them over here. They didn't tell me I got them over here. But what got me when I got to church, oh, Mike, y'all wear your mic up so you get this. Mike didn't have on his gray suit. I mean, Mike don't have on a gray suit. I mean, Mike is the man that tells everybody. How you not gonna tell Mike? You don't tell Mike the word don't get out. And you can tell the word didn't get out because poor Brother Dickerson, he come in with his shirt because Mike didn't get a chance to tell him. If Mike hadn't known, he just told him. Look at Jake. Right, that's another sermon. I'm talking about that one. But my point is this. When it came time to sing, Brother Nixon didn't say y'all can't sing if you don't have on a gray suit.
All right.
Y'all better hear me today. Because I wish I had a really qualifying to sing or not be based on what I have on.
Yeah.
Come on, hear somebody.
Yeah.
I would be based on what's on the inside.
Yeah.
And if I want to glorify the Lord, you can't put new wine in an old bottle. Because the old wineskins had already been stretched. And so when you put the new stuff in there, they want to expand. The old Bible can't handle the expansion. Then you go home and take your favorite bottle of soda that's glass. Don't put no black. A glass and put it in the freezer and see what happens.
Well.
Come on here, somebody. When the content expands beyond the capacity of the container, it will burst.
Yeah.
You gotta have a witness here. And so Jesus said, you don't put the new in the old. Because it's gonna mess up something. Yeah, you're gonna have a problem because the old can't handle the new. You're gonna have a witness here. But Jesus says, people prefer the old wine. You're gonna have a witness here. Oh, yeah. Don't miss it. See, don't listen to what Jesus said and misread what he said. He said, people prefer the old wine. Huh? Because the old is better. Question, is the old better?
Well.
It's been proven that old wine tastes better. Now, see, some of y'all don't understand because you got to be a wine connoisseur. See, people like me, all of it tastes messed up, you know, but I don't have a palate for tasting wine. You gotta get an expert black brother of the mission. I almost called somebody. You have to get somebody who has a palate for wine to appreciate the devil. See, I was in the car. We was like working at Ridgewood Motor Hotel. And Sister Tucker, they had all of the expensive wine. They had a bottle of wine so expensive. And I confess, I didn't do it, but I knew the boys who did, and I probably would have helped them. But they stole a bottle of expensive wine. Wish I had a witness here. I'm in the car with them. I didn't drink. I didn't drink. Not because I'm better than them, I didn't like the taste. If I like the taste, I'm sitting there sweet, man. I prefer a Lehigh grape than a bottle of wine. So I didn't like the taste. But what got me, we in this car full of Negroes, and Brother Dickerson, they start tasting the wine. My cousin, I ain't gonna tell you Russell's name, but he was in the back. He prided himself on taking a spit. And Russell took the spit and that stuff real quick, and he wanted to spit it out. I said, what's wrong with you? That stuff is nasty. I said, man, that's expensive wine. That stuff's supposed to be the best thing. I don't care what it's supposed to be. Man, I'd do better with a bottle of river. I wish I had a river. Y'all missed it. There's some people rather have ripples than a good wine. Do I have a witness here? So is the good wine really good? Do I have a witness? Y'all look at me like I'm making this up. Well, let me give you some proof. You remember that time when Jesus had a wedding feast? There go another wedding feast. Remember what Jesus did when his mama came to him and said they'd run out of wine? What they got to do with me? Come on here, somebody. He said, pour some water in those basins. Put some water in those containers. Do I have a witness here? There's nothing magic about the containers. He just told them to put some water in the container. And remember, nothing happened until they started to pour the content out. Come on, here, somebody. Right. And if they pour the content out, it turned, when the water turned into wine.
Yeah.
That was the first miracle that Jesus wrought. Do you remember what Jesus said when they poured that out? God said, baby, baby, come here, bro, come here, the daddy. Tasted better than old because Jesus made Fragrance and this Sunday. She's requesting our prayer for herself and her family, for strength and for comfort and for healing. She's been coming quite a few Sundays ago. When I was a young preacher, gospel, I had some old people to come. Courage. They told me, "Why not let those people, same people, come up every Sunday for prayer?" I don't have a problem with that. I have a problem with people coming for prayer.
Yeah.
I have a problem with folks sitting there like a lump on the log. I don't ever request nobody to pray for me. Some folks, they're so strong they don't need prayer from somebody else. Paul said, if you don't, I don't care how close you are to the Lord, you ought to be glad somebody else is praying for you. You don't just ask people who are stronger than you to pray for you. You better learn how to ask everybody. You got to be stronger than I am spiritually to pray for you. You pray for me. If you get a prayer, you pray for me. Call my name.
Yeah, Lord.
Because the Bible declares the good and affectionate and fervent prayer for the righteous of the unrighteous. So let's pray for this, our sister, not just her. A whole lot of folks need prayer. I mentioned Sister Matt in the hospital. There are others who need our prayer. We just praise the Lord and we want to call on him right now. I'm going to ask again Brother Clint to come and lead us in this prayer as he prays out of it on every heart. Let's pray. Father God, here we are again at your throne of grace. And we're so glad that you are God. There is none greater than you or ever will be. We come asking, Lord God, because we know that you are able, Lord God. We pray for this young lady, Lord, who's been coming frequently. She's asking for your help, Lord God. You know what she needs, Lord God. Touch her in a special way, Lord God. Bless her family. Bless her. Bless you. grace, ready.